Hello, welcome everybody. Thank you for coming. Welcome to the Geometry Gokuba and or sorry, the Gokuba Geometry and Topology Institute online lecture series. Today we are going to have our second lecture of our series. Our speaker will be Ilya Ittenberg, and he will be telling us about the topology of real algebraic curves and surfaces.
Thank you very much, and well, it's really a pleasure to give this talk. So of course it would be much better if we would all be in Gokuba, and if it would be a true Blackboard talk, but well, I hope we will meet soon in Gokuba, and we'll have soon this standard nice Gokuba talks. So indeed, I plan to speak today about topology of real algebraic curves and surfaces. So the main purpose for today will be to discuss a little bit more in details the topology of real algebraic curves, algebraic curves in RP2. And then if I have time, I will speak about surfaces, algebraic surfaces in RP3 to prepare further discussions, in particular, discussions concerning areas in of considered in K3 surfaces. So let me just recall quickly a few things Grisha discussed yesterday. So we will be interested in topology of algebraic curves in RP2. So we have a polynomial, real polynomial in three variables, f. So we assume that this polynomial is homogeneous. So it's a real homogeneous polynomial, and let's denote the degree by d. And we're interested in the set of zeros of this polynomial. So we'll denote the set of zeros by RC. So this is the set of zeros of our polynomial in RP2. So of course, we can consider also the set of zeros of this polynomial in CP2. So we have this kind of commutative diagram of inclusions. And we will always assume in our discussions today that the curves we are considering are smooth and non-singular. So meaning that our polynomial f does not have critical points. Let me write down this assumption explicitly. So assume that the first partial derivatives of f do not vanish simultaneously in C cube without the origin. So under this assumption, the real point set of our curve, if it's non-empty, it's one-dimensional submanifold of RP2. And so we're interested in the topology of the pair RP2-RC. So we're interested in the topology of this topological pair RP2-RC. And as Grisha explained yesterday, so for small degrees, it's quite easy to understand what can be this topology. So let's do this exercises together for very small degrees. So if d is equal to 1, so of course the real point set of our curve is just a line. So if d is equal to 2, there are two possibilities. So it can happen that the real point set of our curve is empty, and it can happen that the real point set is a circle embedded in RP2 as a circle, so two-sidedly. So the circle separates RP2 in two parts. One part is a disk, and so we say that it's the interior of this component, and such a component is called an oval. So the interior of an oval is a disk, and the exterior, so the second part of RP2, is a Möbius band. And so it's easy to see, for example, just considering standard, using standard arguments about real quadratic forms, that for the topology of this pair RP2 RC with the degree is 2, there are only these two options, either this real point set is empty or it's such a null. So as Grisha explained yesterday, so when d is equal to 3, there are also two possibilities. So the first one is just one component which is embedded in RP2. So it's not a symbol of integral. So it's just a one-dimensional submanifold, so a circle embedded in RP2 in such a way that the circle does not divide RP2 in two parts. So the complement is connected, the complement is disk. In fact, so if you're considering embeddings of a circle in RP2, so there are essentially two options. Either the complement is a disk, so we have such a non-contractible component, or we in the case of an oval, so either we have a non-contractible component or the circle is contractible in RP2, and in this case it's an oval dividing RP2 in two parts, a disk and whatever that. So in degree three, so there is this possibility, and there is another possibility which is a little bit more interesting. We can have a non-contractible component and a null. And so since, as far as I understood, I'm supposed to give exercises. So here is the first exercise. So I claim that, so exercise. So if the degree is the degree d is odd, then the real point set of our curve contains exactly one non-contractible component. So this is sorry.
Smooth assumption, right? Because
it has to yeah. So as I said, so this is my assumption from the beginning. So when I'm so speaking today about algebraic curves in RP2, I'm always supposing that my curves are smooth. So I'm speaking only about non-singular curves. And so this is the first statement, and the second statement, if D is even, then all the connected components of the real point set of our curve are ovals, so embedded in RP2 two-sidedly. If D is even, then all the connected components of RC are ovals. And so coming back to degree three, so we since three is odd, so we have to have one non-contractible component, and the only question is what can be the number of ovals. So my claim is that the number of ovals can be either zero or one. So to show that you cannot have more than one oval, you can either use Harnack's inequality mentioned by Grisha yesterday, or let's pretend that for the moment we don't know this Harnack inequality. We can just use a simple observation based on the Bellew theorem. So if we imagine that our curve has at least two ovals, then what I do? I can take, do this. Let's consider the situation where these two ovals are situated outside of each other. You can treat in a similar way the situation when one oval is inside the other one. So if these two ovals are outside of each other, I can take one point inside of each of these two ovals I'm considering and try to trace a straight line, this straight line through these two points. So my line is not that straight, but so if you trace a straight line through these two points, you immediately see that this red line should intersect each oval at least twice. And so this line should intersect my curve in at least four, in fact, at least five points, because I have two points, at least two points of intersection per oval, and at least one point of intersection with a non-contractible component. So I have at least 5 points of intersection. And this is, of course, too much for a curve of degree three. So this would mean that, in fact, the line is a component of my curve, and it's impossible because my curve is non-singular. So if we assume that we have two ovals situated outside of each other, then we get a contradiction. And you can treat in a similar way the situation when one oval is inside the other. In this case, you can pick just one point inside the interior oval and trace any line, any straight line through this point. And once again, you have at least 5 points of intersection with the curve. So it's impossible. So we proved in particular the Harnack inequality for cubics. And now let's proceed in a similar way in degree four. So if D is equal to four, what are the options? So the complete classification is as follows. So of course, the real point set can be empty. It can be one oval. It can be two ovals, and these ovals can be situated outside of each other, and the second oval can be inside the first one. So these are various options. So let me do it in this way. So these are just various options. And so this, by the way, all these options are easy to realize. You can take, for example, ellipses and take so product of this conics and perturb slightly this product of conics to get a non-singular curve, keeping the topology you want. So you can easily realize all these possibilities. And so if you remember the Harnack inequality, so the Harnack inequality tells us that the maximal number of components is for a curve of degree d in IP2 is d minus 1 times d minus 2 over 2 plus 1. So in the case where d is equal to 4, this Harnack number is equal to 4. So the maximal number of components is 4. So we can have 3 ovals and 4 ovals. And if the number of ovals is bigger than 2, then all ovals are situated outside of each other. Why? Because if we have such a nest of depth 2, so 2 ovals, say that one oval is inside another one, and we have some third oval, we can play once again the same game as before. We can take a point inside the interior oval of the nest, a point inside the third oval, and trace the straight line through these two points. And once again, Bidoux theorem tells us that it's impossible because we have at least 6 points of intersection between these two curves, the white one, so our curve, and this auxiliary curve, which is the red line. So let's try to prove the Harnack inequality in the case of quartics, pretending that we don't know the general statement. So why it's impossible to have more than 4 ovals? Because we can once again play the same game using the Bidoux theorem, but the auxiliary curve will not be of degree 1, will not be a straight line, but it will be conic. So let's assume that we succeeded to find a quartic curve, non-singular curve of degree 4, with at least 5 ovals. So we pick 5 ovals of this curve, and as before, we take one point inside each of these ovals. So now we have 5 points, and through 5 points in IP2, we can always trace a conic. So let's trace this red auxiliary conic. So 5 points. And the number of points of intersection is at least 10. Because this conic should intersect each of the ovals at least twice. And of course, 10 is bigger than 4 times 2. So once again, we get a contradiction using this Bidoux theorem. And let me just notice to finish this classification degree 4 that.
What's that contradiction again? Could you repeat?
The contradiction is that so we have these two curves, the white one, so it's our quartic, and this auxiliary curve, this red conic. And the number of intersection points is at least 10 because the conic should intersect each oval at least twice. So we assume that we have 5 ovals. So we have at least 10 points of intersection. But the Bidoux theorem tells us that the number of points of intersection should be at most 8.
At most 8, okay.
So in fact, the Bidoux theorem tells us that if the, either this conic is a component of my curve, which cannot be the case because my curve is non-singular, or the number of points of intersection is at most 8, and since 10 is greater than 8, we get a contradiction. Okay. And so to finish this classification, let me just note that these two last possibilities, 3 ovals and 4 ovals, you can also easily realize, you can easily construct such quartics. And to do this construction, what you can do, so you can play with 2 ellipses as for previous constructions. But this time you take 2 ellipses intersecting in 4 real points. And so it's also an exercise. So you can try to perturb the product of this two conics. So perturb the union of this two conics. To obtain the situation with the three ovals and to obtain a maximal quartic, so the situation with four ovals. And a little bit more complicated exercise. You can play a similar game in degree five. So classification in degree five is not really more complicated than in degree four. So obtain a classification. So what is called topological classification, classification of pairs IP2RC for non-singular curves of degree five.
Did you just say that the argument before you can perturb this the union of those two ellipses, two different weights, one you get three circles, the other four circles?
Yes. So in fact, you can perturb also to get less ovals, but this we already briefly discussed. So less also the configuration with at most two ovals you can get perturbing a union of non-intersecting ellipses, so non-intersecting in the real plane. But now when I consider the situation with two intersecting ellipses, I claim that there is a possibility to perturb this union to get three ovals, and there is a possibility to obtain four ovals, right?
Perturbing this algebraically means you put this equation.
Perturbing means that for each of these conics I have a polynomial defining this conic. So F1 is a real homogeneous polynomial of degree two defining the first ellipse. F2 is a similar polynomial defining the second ellipse. And then I add a small parameter epsilon. So I take an appropriate polynomial of homogeneous polynomial of degree 4 q, and I add to the product of f1 and f2 this new polynomial, this perturbative polynomial multiplied by a constant, and this constant is let's do it in this way: for sufficiently small positive epsilon. Okay.
And there's some choice for Q how to resolve this thing,
because that. Yeah. So that's right. So your choice now is the choice of Q. Okay. And for example, if for Q you take the sum of fourth powers of variables. Well, and if the signs are chosen appropriately, what you will get on my picture, you will get four ovals like this. Okay. And I claim that if you choose Q in a different way, you can obtain also three ovals. So that In fact, what happens in this situation, so each of the nodes of this union, so we have four intersection points of our ellipses, and each of these intersection points can be perturbed in two different ways. And in fact, I claim that these ways can be chosen independently, one from the others. You can perturb each of them as you want. And in fact, the way so the your choice for each of these points is determined by the sign of Q at this point. Okay.
You say you can do this independently. That means like you take this equation, you put another epsilon.
Two. No. So what I modify when I modify the construction is Q. So epsilon is just I take epsilon sufficiently positive and sufficiently small. So my choice in the construction is the choice of Q.
I understand. You did this for one intersection point. Then you want to do the second intersection.
So Q does it for all the intersection points. But so what I'm saying is that Q has some sign at each intersection point. And this sign determines what happens locally at this point when I perturb.
I see.
And so you can choose Q in such a way that the signs of your Q at these points are as you want, because you can take any polynomial of degree four, right?
Yes, thanks.
And thus you can perturb these double points independently, one from the other. In fact, in this case, it's easy to see and to prove my claim, but it's a general claim. It's called Brizotti theorem. And so the theorem of Brizotti said that if you have a nodal curve, you can perturb double points, so a real nodal curve, you can perturb real nodes of this curve as you want. So for each node, you have two possibilities. You can attribute to each node. So each node generated double point, each real generated double point of the curve, one of two ways. And then Brizotti theorem will realize your wish. So you can do such a perturbation. But in this case, it's really easy to check the statement by hand. So a little bit more complicated exercise is to obtain such a topological classification for non-singular curves of degree five in IP2. And in particular, we'll see that the if you do this exercise, that the only maximal in the sense of Harnack inequality configuration in degree five is like this. So you have, of course, a non-contractible component because the degree is odd, and then the Harnack number is seven. So you can have at most six ovals, and these six ovals necessarily lie outside of each other. Once again, because of this argument using the Bezout theorem. So, as Grisha said yesterday, all this was known to Hilbert when he formulated his 16th problem, and he was interested in particular in topology of curves of degree six. So this is, in a sense, the first really complicated case. So I will not present a complete classification, a complete topological classification, because if I would try to do it, I would have to draw 56 curves. So because there are 56 possible topological types of pairs IP2RC for a non-singular curve of degree six. But let me just recall you that the maximal configurations, once again, maximal in the sense of Harnack inequality, as follows. So you can have, so the Harnack number is 11, so we can have 9 ovals outside and 1 oval inside of another oval. So it's so-called Harnack curve. So we can have a symmetric configuration, so-called Hilbert curve. So the curve that was constructed by Hilbert. So 9 ovals inside and 1 oval outside. And there is also a configuration realized by Gudkov with 5 ovals inside and 5 ovals outside. So let me, well, it's also an exercise, but probably not an immediate exercise, but still you can do this, you can try to do this exercise. You can try to prove Harnack inequality, pretending that we don't know this Harnack inequality in the case of sextets, in a way similar to what we did in the case of cubics and quartics. So just let's observe what we did. In the case of cubics, we used an auxiliary line. In the case of quartics, we used an auxiliary conic. So the case of quintics, we didn't discuss in details, but in fact, you can prove this Harnack inequality in the case of quintics using an auxiliary cubic. And so you definitely guessed what is the degree of an auxiliary curve to consider. So to prove the statement in degree 6, you can use an auxiliary curve of degree 4. And in general, the Harnack inequality can be proved. And this is the way Harnack proved this inequality. You can consider an auxiliary curve of degree D minus 2. So when you want to prove the statement for degree D, you use such an auxiliary curve of degree D minus 2. So this is
so these are all the maximum configurations plus altogether 56. No,
56 is a total number of configurations, not necessarily maximal. So
I know.
In degree 6, there are only 3 maximal configurations, but the total number of configurations.
These are the pictures plus 56 others that we don't know.
Plus 53, because they are among 56. So 56 is a total number, and so there are these 3 maximal configurations plus 53 other configurations. And so what I was saying that to prove the Harnack inequality, one can use an auxiliary curve of degree D minus 2. Now, this was the proof by Harnack. As Grisha mentioned yesterday, in the same volume of Mathematische Annalen, so in the same volume as the Harnack paper, there is a paper by Klein where, in particular, at the end of this paper, Klein explains how to prove the Harnack inequality in much more transparent and understandable way. And moreover, Klein's proof works in a more general situation than the Harnack's one. And so this Klein's, let me mention briefly this Klein's proof of the Harnack inequality. So, the main idea of this proof is that instead of working only with the real point set of our curve, we should think about the complex point set of our curve. So we consider now the complex point set of our curve, and the complex point set lives in CP2. And the involution of complex conjugation acting in CP2 restricts to an involution, I will denote C, on the complex point set of our curve, since our curve is real. And the real part is the fixed point set of this involution on the curve. In fact, as you will see in this proof, the only important thing about this involution is that this involution is orientation reversing. So the Harnack proof, well, I'm sorry. So the proof of by Harnack, so this proof with auxiliary curves uses the Bezout theorem, and in fact Harnack works with algebraic curves in IP2, so it's important for this proof. Klein's proof works in a much more general situation. You have this Riemann surface, and you can think just about topological surface with an orientation reversing evolution. And the claim is that the number of connected components of the fixed point set of this involution is at most the genus of the surface plus one. So why? So we have this Riemann surface S. And so what we can do, we can consider S tilde, which is S quotient by the involution. Okay, let me try to draw this quotient, and this is a surface with boundary if the real point set of our curve is non-empty, and I don't want to have this boundary, so I will just glue the disks, so one disk per component of the fixed point set of the involution. So the number of disks we glue is equal to the number of components of the real point set of our curve. So now we have a topological surface without boundary, and the only thing we will use about this topological surface, which is connected, in that the early characteristic of the surface is at most two. Because what is the early characteristic? The early characteristic of the quotient of S is one half of two minus two G, or G the genus of our topological surface. And then I added L disks, so the early characteristic is one half of d minus 2g plus L. So thus L is at most g plus one, the end of the proof. So it's really useful to not to to work only with the real point set the curve under consideration. This Klein's proof shows that it's really useful to consider also the complex point set of this curve, and to think about real curves as complex curves equipped with an anti-holomorphic involution. Okay, so now let me see what. Yeah, so let's come back to our discussion of maximal configurations of curves of degree six.
Harnack's so, group only involved Bezos' technique, right? When Harnack proved his inequality before, he only used Bezos, right?
So yes, so in Harnack's proof, so Harnack's proof was using these auxiliary curves and the Bezos theorem. So he proved this inequality just considering an auxiliary curve of degree d minus two and generalizing, in fact, the what we did in the case of degree three and degree four. Exactly. So his proof is not really complicated, but first of all, it's definitely more complicated than and less transparent than Klein's proof. And as I said, one of big advantages of Klein's proof is that this proof works in a more general situation. So it works not just for algebraic curves in IP2, it works just for topological surfaces equipped with orientable topological surfaces equipped with orientation reversing involution. So let's come back to this discussion of maximal configurations in degree six. In fact, when Gudkov obtained when he finished the classification of curves of complete classification of curves of degree six, and he obtained this description of maximal configurations, he noted that the result for this maximal configurations can be formulated in the form of some congruence. So let's speak now about this. What is
I have a question.
Yes.
So you have one inequality, which is Harnack inequality. It tells you what is the like number of maximal curves, and the other one is that you used to guess the configuration. You're using that auxiliary curves, and you count the intersection, and you get some number, right? Like, yes. For instance, when these six, you get like, I guess, eight, or these four, you get something six. So how do you get that number? What is that theorem?
No. So in fact, well, I think you're asking me how to do this exercise, how to generalize the proof we did. Degree four. So in fact, what you should do. So you, well, what you can do. So if you decide to use an auxiliary curve of degree d minus two, so as far as I understood your question, you're asking how many points should you take to consider this auxiliary curve. So it's a general observation which is easy, that if you want to trace a curve of degree d, say, you can take d times d plus three over two points in the projective plane, and through these points you will be able to trace a curve of degree d. So if you want to trace a curve of degree d minus two, then you can take d minus two times d plus one over two points, and through these points you will be able to trace a curve of degree d minus two. So in fact, so if you consider the space of all curves of degree d, okay, all curves of degree d in IP2, this space can be identified with a projective space of dimension d times d plus three over two. So the number I was describing is just the dimension of the projective space. You just count the coefficients of all possible polynomials defining your curves. And the coefficients give you homogeneous coordinates in this projective space. So the dimension is the number of coefficients, number of possible monomials minus one. And then what I am saying is that the condition to pass through a given point in terms of this space of curves, in the terms of this projective space, is just a hyperplane. So each point defines a hyperplane in this projective space. So if you take d times d plus 3 over 2 points, so we will have d times d plus 3 over 2 hyperplanes in this projective space of dimension d times d plus 3 over 2. So they will have at least one point of intersection. This will be your curve of degree d. So you should play this game for curves, auxiliary curves of degree d minus 2.
So roughly, the technique of using auxiliary curves in Bezout tells you how they distribute these ovals. The other technique is number of,
So in fact, I will not be able to if I use this approach, I will not be able to really to control how these ovals are distributed. This was the case for degrees three.
I mean, it helps you towards understanding distribution.
Unfortunately, not really. So it's an illusion because it was the case, you are completely right, for degrees three and four, because the auxiliary curves were of degree one and two. So they were rational. In particular, the real paths were connected. That's why it worked in this very nice way in our proofs. But if you use auxiliary curves of higher degrees, the real point set and of such a curve is not necessarily connected. So you will not be really able to control the position of ovals one with respect to the others. So in fact, in this in higher degrees, to generalize this approach, and this is really directly related to your question, so you will have to take points through which you trace curves on your curve, just to guarantee the points of intersection. In particular, you can take one point per oval. This will guarantee 2 points of intersection with this oval, but the ovals that were not used to choose points, you will not get any information about them.
Okay, I see.
And this is, by the way, why Rochlin was interested in this question, whether it's true that through 3D minus 1 points in general position on RP2, one can always trace a rational curve of degree D, real rational curve of degree D. Because he wanted to generalize these arguments in degree 3 and degree 4 in such a way that the real point set of the auxiliary curve is connected. So how one can guarantee that the real point set is connected? One way is to play just with rational curves. And that's why he was interested in the existence of such real rational curves of degree D passing through 3D minus 1 points in general position. This is the origin of what we call now Rochlin's question. So come back to this Gudkov Rochlin congruence. So what is this congruence? So first of all, I should introduce some characteristics. So then standard notations for these characteristics are P and M for curves of even degree. So let's now assume that the degree is even, so D is 2K. And if I have a curve of even degree, so all the connected components are ovals, and these ovals can be divided in two groups. So even ovals and odd ovals. So I will define this notion in a minute. So P will be the number of even ovals, and N will be the number of odd ovals. And so what is an even oval? So for each oval, you can count the number of ovals containing your oval inside. So for example, for this oval, so this oval is contained inside one oval. Yes, it is in the interior of one oval, so this oval is odd. So if my oval is contained inside an even number of ovals, my oval is even, otherwise it's odd. Another way to define this notion is to speak about the sign of F at points of RP2. So remember that my curve is defined by a real homogeneous polynomial. And since I'm speaking about a polynomial of even degree, for each point of RP2, I can speak about the sign of my polynomial at this point. So the sign is zero if my point is on the curve. And if my point is outside of the curve, the sign is either plus or minus. So of course, I can multiply F by minus one to switch pluses to minuses and minuses to pluses, because my polynomial, so if I'm interested just in my curve, so my polynomial is defined up to multiplication by a non-zero constant. But in any case, we have two halves of RP2. So the half of RP2, I will denote RP2 plus. So this is a half where my polynomial is non-negative, and the half where my polynomial is non-positive. And then, so one of them is non-orientable, and I can always assume that the non-orientable half is RP2 minus. So I will assume that the sign of F is chosen in such a way that RP2 is non-orientable. And so of course, RP2 minus is non-orientable, and RP2 plus is orientable.
I'm sorry, I missed the sign convention. So you were saying odd and even ovals. Did I understand?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Even outside or odd outside of this oval. So what is this plus minus? Resistance?
Okay, let me describe this sign convention once again. But let me first show on my picture. So this is what I call RP2 plus, and RP2 minus is the other half of RP2. So this is my same convection. So we agree that once we have fixed F, a polynomial defining my curve, so there are two halves. The half where the two halves of RP2, the half where my polynomial is positive and the half where my polynomial is negative, right? So now I can switch the roles of the spots multiplying my polynomial by minus one. And so my sign convention is as follows. So notice that one of the halves is non-orientable. So one of the halves contains this connected component, which is outside of all the ovals. So I assume that the sign of my polynomial is chosen in such a way that it's negative on this exterior part. In particular, RP2 plus is what I have shown on my picture. So of course, this is also the part of RP2 plus. Selman, is it okay?
Where's the center of Möbius band here?
Sorry?
Where's the Möbius band? There's a
the non-orientable component is here. So it's a Möbius band with holes.
Okay, so this outside of this.
So the outside part of the ovals. I assume that on this part, my polynomial is negative.
Okay. Yeah. And then you look at the components that live in the disk part of this RP2, and then you look at the sign of your polynomial of each.
So but the sign of my polynomial changes each time I intersect the curve, right? So each time I intersect transversely the curve, I change the sign of my polynomial. So the exterior, it's negative. Then once I intersect transversely one oval, the sign becomes positive and so on.
What do you mean you intersect polynomial with what? I mean, you have this polynomial, zeros of this polynomial.
Yes, so what I'm saying, so once, so if I am outside, so I have a point outside, so my convention is that the sign of my polynomial, this blue point, is negative.
Okay.
Then I move my point, so at some moment, the point is on the curve, so the polynomial is zero, and then I intersect this oval transversely going inside. So at this moment, I change the sign of my polynomial at the point considered, right?
Okay.
Well, I mean, so it was negative outside, now it becomes positive for the point where I am.
Okay.
So I just travel in RP2 looking at the sign of the polynomial defining my curve at the point where I am at this point, or at this moment, okay?
Okay.
And so outside it's negative, and there is this green half, which is RP2 plus, and the other half is RP2 minus. And so let's just note that even ovals are exactly the ovals bounding this green half from outside, right? So if another interpretation for P is just the number of connected components of RP2 plus. So P is the number of connected components of RP2 plus. And what is N? Any guesses? So in fact, N is the number of orientable components of RP2 minus. So in fact, N plus one is the number of connected components of RP2 minus. And you can also observe some other important characteristics of RP2 plus and RP2 minus playing with P and N. So what is P minus N? So if you think about this difference, you will see immediately that this is the early characteristic of RP2 plus. And you can also express the early characteristic, of course, of RP2 minus. It's N minus P plus one.
Just and so, quick reminder, we're almost out of time. So like five more minutes.
Yes, I'm finishing just formulating the congruence. So this Gudkov-Rochlin congruence is as follows. So the congruence is so for maximal curves, maximal in the sense of Harnack inequalities, so for M curves or maximal curves of degree 2k in IP2, one has the following congruence. So P minus N, which is the early characteristic of RP2 plus, is congruent to K square. K is the half of the degree. Oops, what did I do? To K square modulo 8. So we will not have time today to speak about surfaces, so we'll do it on Friday, but in particular, we will see that this congruence is related to famous Rockland congruence, famous Rockland congruences, model 16 in four-dimensional topology. But let me just finish by proposing one extra exercise. Just use this congruence, so for the moment you should believe me that this congruence is true. Use this congruence to show that the only maximal configurations, only possible maximal configurations in degree six are among these three possibilities. So in fact, this congruence excludes all the other options among, so if you think about such a configuration, alpha ovals inside and beta ovals outside, where alpha plus beta is equal to 10, because the total number of ovals is 11. These are the only three options remaining after this consideration of Gudkov-Rockland congruence. And so we will come back to this congruence and to another restriction on the topology of curves called Petrovskian inequalities the next time. And we will speak also about topology of surfaces next time before discussing the K3 surfaces in more details. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much. That was a great talk. Let's thank our speaker.
May I ask, continue asking this stupid questions that, you know, I get stuck always. This RP2 plus and RP2 minus are the union of components, complements of the curve, right?
You can work with open subsets, or you can consider this components with boundaries. So these are unions of components of the complement, but with the boundary. So I include the boundary in RP2 plus and RP2 minus. So I include the real point set in both of them.
You assign sign to them by this convention.
I'm sorry, someone say it again.
You assign signs to these components.
Yes. Right? So what I'm saying is that each time you have you fix a polynomial defining your curve, for each component of the complement, you have a sign.
Yes.
Plus or minus.
Okay. Thank you.
And so the union of components with associated sign plus is RP2 plus, and the union of components associated with associated sign minus is RP2 minus. But what I was saying is that in principle, since your polynomial f is defined up to multiplication by non-zero constant, you can switch the roles of RP2 plus and RP2 minus if you define them in this way. And so you need some convention to fix what half you will really call RP2 plus and what half you will call RP2 minus. And so this was the main purpose of my convention. So if I consider the connected components of the complement of my curve, if you're right, so exactly one of these connected components is non-orientable. So I assume that my polynomial is chosen in such a way that it takes negative values on this non-orientable component of the complement.
Thank you very much. That's great. Thanks.
Yep. And if anyone else has questions, feel free to ask.
Is there a bond on the depth of these nets, obviously, other than the ones we can obtain from the Bezout's theorem?
I'm sorry, bounds on what?
A depth of these nets of ovals. Oh.
So this is a very, very, very good question. So there is a bound one can get easily using the Bezout theorem. So a nest is a collection of ovals positioned in this way. So each next oval is inside of all the previous ovals. And of course, so if the degree is D, you can get this bound, the integer part of D over 2 for the depth of the NES, just considering a point inside the most interior oval of the nest and tracing an auxiliary line through this point, because this line will have to intersect each oval of the nest at least twice. So if the degree is even, you cannot have more than D over 2 ovals. And if the degree is odd, D over 2 is not an integer, but you cannot have more than the integer part of D over 2, right? So this red line will intersect in the case of odd degree, will intersect, at least once the non-orientable component. Okay. So you get this upper bound for the depth of the nest. I hope that this is clear. And as far as I understood your question, you ask whether it's possible to have a stronger bound. And the answer is no, because you can easily realize a curve having a nest of such depth. Okay, let's do it for even degree. So let's construct a curve of degree D where D is 2K with a nest of depth K. Just take K concentric circles, take the union of these conics and perturb it slightly, keeping the topology of the real point set. Yeah. So you will have a nest of depth K. And in odd degree, you can play the same game, adding to this union just a line non-intersecting your circles. Okay, so this Bezout type consideration gives a sharp upper bound for the depth of nests.
What about the maximal curves? I mean, in that case, we can't play this game, right?
So, you were asking about maximal. Okay, so in the maximal case, so what happens is that, of course, once again, the same argument shows that starting from degree 4, if you have such a nest of maximal depth, you don't have a maximal curve, because if you have such a maximal nest, you don't have any other oval, right? So for a maximal curve starting from degree 4, it's impossible to have this maximal nest, but it's possible in any degree to have a nest of sub-maximal depth. So for example, for even degree, for a maximal curve starting from degree 4, you don't have a nest of depth K, but K minus 1 is already realizable.
Oh, thank you.
Okay, if there aren't any more questions, let's thank our speaker again. And we will turn the recording off and do more informal discussion after this.